Let's discuss now the case of the linear discriminant analysis when we have more than two classes. So in this case, the reasoning is going to be the same as for two classes. We are aiming to find some projection, some reduction in our in the dimensions of our data set in such a way that after projecting, we have the means of the classes separated as much as possible and a scatter of the scatters of the examples from each class to be as low as possible. And in this case, we will need more than just one vector. So instead of a vector, we are going to aim to find a matrix W. And we are going to focus on this product between W transposed and X. And obviously, X is d-dimensional as always. And we will aim to have a reduction to a smaller k, so k-dimensional. And I will come back to this in just a moment, you know, who is k and how to choose it. And matrix W is d times k. And similar as we had for two classes, we think about this within class scatter matrix. For class CI, and this is defined as SI equals sum by T of RIT times XT minus MI, that's the mean of the samples in class I, times XT minus MI transposed. And the labels, I'm just going to write here, the labels are RIT is equal to 1 if XT is in class CI and it's 0 otherwise. So we have this one hot encoding of our labels, just like we had many times before. And the total within class scatter is, and again, similar as we had in the case of two classes, we have this denoted by SW, so it's the scatter associated to matrix W, to be simply the sum of all these within class scatter matrices. So we have sum from 1 to capital K of SI. And when we have more than two classes, the scatter of the means is calculated as how much they are scattered around the overall mean. So the overall mean this is going to be M is just the average of all these class means. And the between class scatter matrix this is defined SB, so B from between, this is sum for all the classes, so I from 1 to K, we have NI, and I comment in just a moment who NI is, MI minus M times MI minus M transposed. And this NI is nothing else but the sum of these labels, so sum, or if you like, you know, the number of samples in each class CI. So the between class scatter matrix after projection is W transpose times SB times W, and the within class scatter matrix after projection is W transpose times SW times W, and these are both K times K matrices. So I'm going to write this here. So on one hand, we have the between class scatter after projection, and this is W transposed times SB times W, and this is a K times K. And again, as I promised, I will come back to this who is this small k at the end. And the within class scatter after projection this is W transposed SW times W, and this is also a K by K matrix. And we want the first one, the between class scatter, to be large, in other words, in the new k-dimensional space where we want our data to be after the projection, we want class means to be as far apart from each other as possible. And we want the second scatter, this one, to be small. So in other words, after projection, we want samples from the same class to be as close to their means as possible. And this is the same reasoning we had when we had just two classes. And so for a scatter, or if you like, for a covariance matrix, a measure of the spread is the determinant, and this follows also from remembering that the determinant is the product of the eigenvalues, and an eigenvalue gives the variance along its corresponding eigenvector. And so our objective is going to be to find W that maximizes this J of W, defined in this case to be in this way, is the determinant of the first matrix, so W transposed SB times W, over the determinant of the second one, W transposed SW times W. And the largest eigenvectors of SW to power minus 1 times SB are the solution. So solution we will take the largest eigenvectors of SW minus 1 times SB. And SB is the sum of a number of matrices of rank 1, one for each class, and only K minus 1 of them are independent. And so SB has a maximum rank, so SB has maximum rank K minus 1, and we will take, so choose the small k that I talked about to be exactly K minus 1. And so in this way, we are going to define a new lower K minus 1 dimensional space where this discriminant is then to be constructed. And even though LDA uses class separability as its goodness criterion, any classification method can be used in this new space for estimating the discriminants for our classification problem. So this concludes the discussion on the linear discriminant analysis. And I hope that in after this lecture, it becomes a little bit more clear in what way This method is using the labels of the classes to separate the examples as much as possible. Just one more example to make this comparison between PCA and LDA clearer. We have in this plot, we have a number of data points coming from two different classes. One class is this one denoted by red pluses, and the other class is denoted by these blue circles. And if you take the PCA approach, you are going to get this this vector. And remember, this is very natural because PCA, the logic behind PCA was that you are going to select that dimension which preserves as much as possible the you know, the spread of your data, so the variance of the data. So that's going to be this vector here, because this is where you will have these data points preserved, you know, the distances between them preserved as much as possible. On the contrary, LDA takes this approach that you would like to have the means of the data points projected on this vector as far away as possible from each other, and also the data points within a class as much as possible grouped with each other. And that's going to give us, in fact, this vector here, because when we project class, the red class is going to be pretty much grouped within just one point, and pretty much the blue class is going to be you know, projected into just one single point. Now, when you look at the consequences of the PCA and the LDA projection, so when you project along the vector identified by PCA, you are going to get these data points. And again, this is completely successful from the point of view of the logic behind PCA, because it preserves the spread of the data points both in the red class and in the blue class. On the contrary, on LDA, again, it's very successful, but from a very different point of view, and that is to separate these classes as much as possible. The means are as much as possible separated from each other, and the points are grouped together as much as possible within a class. So there you have it. PCA is more worried about the spread out of the data without ever looking at the labels, the class that they are coming from. So just preserve the spread out of your data. And LDA takes a fundamental look at the labels, and it says, well, I want to separate the classes as much as possible, and it comes with a very different solution.